The news of Gandhi's advent and the nature of his mission spread quickly to Muzaffarpur and to Champaran. Sharecroppers from Champaran began arriving on foot and getting ready to see their champion. So Gandhi reached Muzaffarpur from Muzaffarpur, he reached Champaran. Right? So at that time,
so Gandhi had reached that place, and when he reached over there, then everyone, the poor farmers, they all got to know that somebody, the one who is going to fight for them, that some kind of Mahatma has come. So they reached that place where Gandhi had come. They came either on foot or they came by conveyance just to see this man. The point is, like, when you are there to help the needy and the downtrodden, then you are not alone. Once you stand up for some cause, then you cannot be ever alone. Okay? But your mission should be pious. Your mission, or your, you know, the kind of thing you want to do in your life, that should have a pious purpose. Any selfish motive, you know, end up with a disastrous failure. Mind it, Gandhi was never a failure because his mission was always pure and pious. So the moment he reached Muzaffarpur, all the poor and downtrodden, all those poor sharecroppers and farmers, you know, they reached there to see this man. The purpose is they reached there to support him. So this sharecroppers from Champaran began arriving on foot and by conveyance to see their champion. Muzaffarpur lawyers called on Gandhi to brief him. So Muzaffarpur lawyers, they came to Gandhi to tell him about the status of situation. Like, what was the scenario there? Okay. They frequently represented peasant groups in court. They told him about the cases and reported the size of their fee. So those lawyers, they came to Gandhi and told Gandhi, like, how they used to represent the cases in the courts and the way they used to take big fee, hefty fee from the poor farmers. Were the lawyers right? Were they justified in taking the fee from the poor farmers? Tell me, children. So when this case, when these sharecroppers were fighting for justice, when they had filed cases in the courts, who will fight case for them? Okay, who will be there with them in the court? The lawyers. And who were the lawyers? The lawyers were Indians. So was it justified that the Indian lawyers took hefty fee from the poor farmers to help them take justice? Was it justified? Tell me. Were the farmers fighting for themselves only? So, yes. So it was not justified, yes. Vanshika, am I clear now? Is my voice clear? Okay, the news, so Muzaffarpur lawyers called on. Okay, beta, thank you. So Muzaffarpur lawyers called on Gandhi to brief him. They frequently represented peasant groups in courts. They told him about their cases and reported the size of their fee. Gandhi chided the lawyers for collecting big fee from the sharecroppers. What is chided? Scolded. So Gandhi scolded the lawyers for getting or collecting high fee from the sharecroppers. Why did he scold the lawyers? Because the lawyers were also Indians and they should have helped the poor Indian sharecroppers to get justice from the foreigners. Okay? He said, I have come to the conclusion He said, I have come to the conclusion that we should stop going to law courts. Taking such cases to the courts does little good. Where the peasants are so crushed and fear-stricken, law courts are useless. The real relief for them is to be free from fear. So children, the moment Gandhi reached Muzaffarpur, or you can say Champaran, before he headed for any other details, in the very beginning when he got to know the Indians were crushing, or the Indians were exploiting the Indians, or when he got to know that the poor farmers were so afraid that they did not have the guts to fight their own battle. So then he concluded that it is useless to go to courts. Unless and until we are free from fear, we cannot ever be, you know, free from the clutches of slavery. So the very first thing he concluded at that place where he went to help the sharecropper was, he told them that unless and until you are fearless, you cannot win any battle. You may go to any court. You may go to Supreme Court or High Court, or you may go to the International Court. But unless you are fearless, you will not be able to win. Right? So most of the arable land in the Champaran district was divided into large estates owned by Englishmen and worked by Indian tenants. So now, children, we come to know about the background. Like, what was the problem for which Gandhi went to Champaran? What was the problem? The problem was that at that time, the arable, that is agricultural land, okay, the land which was fit for agriculture. So most of the agricultural land in Champaran was divided into large estates. And those large estates were owned by Englishmen. So the English, the Britishers were the owners of those agricultural lands. And because the English, they could not do the farming, they were not the workers. So that land was given to the Indian farmers to work upon it. Okay, the farming was done by farmers, Indian tenants. So the Indian farmers were tenants. Got it? And the owners were Britishers. You people tell me one thing. Can a foreigner be the owner of land in India? Can a foreigner be the owner of land in India? Tell me. If a Britisher comes to India, can he become the owner of some land over here? Yes or no? No. So he cannot be the owner. A foreigner, if he comes to India, he cannot be the owner. Why he can't be the owner? Because number one, in India, there are many laws which don't permit a foreigner to buy Indian land. Right? So there are certain laws. But in those days, foreigners came to India and they became the owners. They started ruling over India. Did somebody officially hand over India to them? Did somebody give them their lands officially? The answer is no. At the time the Britishers came, and they confiscated, they snatched the Indian lands. So basically, Indian land was of Indians. And the Britishers had just confiscated that. And they victimized the Indian farmers. Why were they able to victimize the Indian farmers? Because the farmers were weak. Why were they weak? Because they did not have the courage to speak to the Britishers. They did not have the courage to tell the Britishers that this is our land and how can you be the owner? Right? So far, if in Champaran, the farmers were suffering, they were suffering not because they did not have any right, but because they did not have the courage to say that it was their own land. The only problem in Champaran was the lack of awareness or the lack of courage, nothing else. And Gandhi just taught Indians over there that this is your land and no one has the right to take your land from you. That is what Gandhi did over there. Gandhi did not put himself, Gandhi did not, presented himself, did not present himself as a leader, as a, you know, politician. He told the Indians the way to fight. That is what he did. That's why he is a great leader. Leader is not the one who says that I am your leader and what I say that is correct. Leader is the one who shows the way to the others. And this is what he did. It's not that Gandhi had already made a plan like how he will fight the case. Gandhi, when he reached over there, he realized like what was lacking amongst Indians. And because of those weaknesses, Indians were dominated by Britishers. And he started telling Indians to overcome those weaknesses. And the first weakness was, what was the first weakness of Indians at that time, children? Come on, tell me. What was the first weakness of the Indians at that time? Raise hand. What was the first weakness of the Indians at that time? Come on. Yes, Charanjot, give the answer.
Good morning, ma'am.
Yeah, good morning, beta. Yes, Charanjot, belated happy birthday.
At that time, Indians were not in unity.
Yes, you are right. The first weakness of the Indians was that they were not united. Why were they not united? Because they were not courageous. So the very first weakness of the Indians at that time was that they were not courageous. And secondly, they were not united. And Gandhi worked upon these weaknesses first. He made Indians courageous. He did not make Indians courageous, thereby giving them armaments. He did not give them guns and pistols and swords. He just told them, like, you have your rights on your own land. No foreigner can tell us what we have to do in our land. This is what he only did. The chief, estates were owned by Englishmen and worked by Indian tenants. The chief commercial crop was indigo. The landlords compelled all tenants to plant 3/20 or 15% of their holdings with indigo and surrender the entire indigo harvest as rent. This was done by a long-term contract. So this is the root of the problem. So at the time when the Britishers were the owners and the Indian farmers were working as tenants upon the land, they were forced by the Britishers to grow 15% of their, to grow indigo upon the 15% of land. Okay, so indigo was the main crop. It was the main commercial crop of that time. So the farmers would grow indigo on 15% of their land. And this entire indigo would be handed over to the Britishers as a rent. Got it? So whatever the indigo harvest would be, the farmers would give it fully to the Britishers. Got it? So rest of the crop they could have. So presently the landlords learned that German had developed synthetic indigo. They thereupon obtained agreements from the sharecroppers to pay them compensation for being released from the 15% arrangement. So children, later on, the Britishers got to know that the German also had a better synthetic indigo. Now they wanted Indian farmers. They told Indian farmers not to give them indigo. Rather, they told Indian farmers to give them that much of compensation in cash. Got it? Earlier, the farmers used to give the indigo crop as rent, but now they were told to give them that much in cash. So it was here where the problem started rising, where the problem, it became the climax of the problem. Because the farmers could not afford that much of cash. Okay, so they thereupon obtained agreements from the sharecroppers to pay them compensation for being released from the 15% arrangement. Got it? So instead of getting the indigo harvest, they asked them to give them that much compensation in cash. So they got that those kinds of agreements signed by those poor illiterate farmers. The sharecropping arrangement was irksome to the peasants and many signed willingly. So the sharecropping arrangement, what was the sharecropping arrangement? That they would be giving 15% of the harvest, that they would be giving that much of rent in cash. So this arrangement was quite irritating, annoying to the farmers, but some of them signed willingly. Some farmers signed because they were illiterate and they were not able to make out like what would be the repercussions later on. Or you can say that they did not have the courage to foresee the events. But those who resisted, engaged lawyers. So those who did not sign, they got lawyers. The landlords hired thugs. So the landlords, the owners of the land, they also hired thugs. Who are the thugs? The rascals, the villains. Okay, the people who would fight for the cash. Meanwhile, the information about synthetic indigo reached the illiterate peasants who had signed and they wanted their money back. So meanwhile, when all farmers got to know the reality that the Britishers were not getting indigo from them because they had started getting it from German, then they became annoyed and they wanted the money back. Which money? Which they had given as compensation. At this point, Gandhi arrived. So it was here at this point that Gandhi reached Champaran. Got it? So you should know the background, like what made Gandhi, why was Gandhi invited to Champaran by Rajkumar Shukla? Who was Rajkumar Shukla? Rajkumar Shukla was one of those sharecroppers, the one who was a victim of sharecropping arrangement. Okay, he was also the one Indian peasant, the one who was working upon the land as a tenant. So at this point, Gandhi arrived in Champaran. He began by trying to get the facts. First, he visited the secretary of the British Landlords Association. The secretary told him that he could give no information to an outsider, mind it. Gandhi answered that he was no outsider. So children, Gandhi went to Champaran to get justice for the poor farmers. So when he went over there, it's not that he told all the farmers like, "Ki, come with me, let us go and gharao the government and all." He being an educated person, he wanted the documents, that is the evidences in his favor first. So he went in for the right information or evidences or proof. What proof? What kind of proof did Gandhi want? Gandhi wanted the proof that this Indian land is of Indian farmers. Why should they give rent to the foreigners? So that was the very first concept Gandhi had with him. So whenever you go for any fight, first see the root, like whether the main, the very, very fact upon which you're going to fight for, is that fact, does that fact have any base? The fight for which you're going to gharao the authorities, does your argument have any base or is it baseless? So Gandhi had that base. What was the base? That why should the farmers pay rent when they were the owners? And this is what he wanted the proofs now, like the farmers are the owners. And for that, it's not that he will just speak that farmers were owners. he will gather the documents, because documents are always there. Okay, if somebody tells you that the house where you are living, if somebody comes and tells you that this is my house, will you agree? Anyone can say that this is my house, but unless the person who will have the documents of the house, the one who will have the registry in one's name, that person is the owner of the house. Anyone can say that I am the owner of the house. So the one who will have the documentary proof will have the right to say that it's mine. So Gandhi first of all wanted to get the facts. He visited the secretary of the British Landlords Association, and that secretary told him that we won't give any information to the outsider. So see, and Gandhi told him, like, who is the outsider? You people or me? So next, Gandhi called on the British official commissioner of the Tirhut division, in which the Champaran district lay. Then Gandhi met the British official commissioner. Okay, first he went to the secretary of the British Landlords Association. That person did not give him any help because he considered him to be an outsider. Then Gandhi went to the British official commissioner of Tirhut division, in which the Champaran district lay. The commissioner proceeded to bully me and advised me forthwith to leave Tirhut. So what did that commissioner do? That commissioner told Gandhi to leave Champaran. Got it? Why was Gandhi told to leave Champaran? Because he was told that you are not from Bihar. You don't belong to Champaran. Why have you come here? If you have come from Gujarat, go back. So was Gandhi an outsider? If we go to Mumbai, will those people call us outsiders? Can they? No one can. Because we are free to move about in our own country. We may go to Kashmir, we may go to Tamil Nadu, we may go to Bengal, we may go to Maharashtra, and those people can come to Punjab. Because we are all Indians. And this thing should know, we don't need to understand this, we should know this. But at that time, if the Britishers did not know this, no great wonders. Because this is what for they had come to India. Okay, Gandhi was told to leave Tirhut. Gandhi did not leave. Instead, he proceeded to Motihari, the capital of Champaran. So Gandhi was told to leave Tirhut, but Gandhi did not leave. Instead of leaving, he went to Motihari, which was the capital of Champaran. Got it? So what is it? Gandhi was told, like, you leave Tirhut. Gandhi, instead of leaving, he went to the capital of Champaran. So what is it? It is a disobedience of the law. And Gandhi will very, very beautifully explain in the next page, like, did he disobey the law because he was an unlawful person? Did he disobey the law because he was because he did not like to follow the laws? He will answer the question very beautifully, that I did not disobey the law because of any insincerity towards my nation, but I disobeyed the law because I wanted to be sincere to humanity. What was humanity? There is nothing, you won't have ever a bigger cause than the cause for your nation. When you cannot be true to your nation, you cannot be true to anyone or anything. The very first and foremost duty of all of us is to be true to our nation. And this is what Gandhi said. He said, right now I am fighting for my own countrymen. I'm not fighting for the Biharis, or I'm not fighting for the Punjabis, or I'm not fighting for the Marathas. I'm fighting for Indians against the foreigners. Gandhi did not leave. Instead, he proceeded to Motihari, the capital of Champaran, several lawyers accompanied him at the railway station. Okay, so he went to Motihari and several lawyers came with him to the railway station. A vast multitude greeted Gandhi. So remember, children, when Gandhi had reached Champaran, no one knew him. Nobody knew him. But when he reached there, the multitude greeted him. Multitude means so many people, big crowd. More than thousands of people greeted him there. So when you are on the right mission, you are never alone. He went to a house and, using it as headquarters, continued his investigations. So he used one house as headquarters, and from there he kept on gathering the evidences. He did not reach the headquarters to make people against Britishers. Remember, these are very, very important things for we people to understand, especially for those who are posing themselves as the leaders nowadays. Okay, here this, you know, Gandhi, he reached there and started getting evidences, gathering evidences. He did not start instigating the public against Britishers. And you people will see that Gandhi will even help the Britishers in controlling the crowd. Right now, after 75 years of independence, we have the great leaders, those who instigate the public to go against the government. But here we had Gandhi, the one who helped the foreigners in controlling the crowd. Remember, children, crowd is never sensible. Crowd is always, I don't say like crowd is senseless always, but yes, when there is a crowd, don't expect crowd to be disciplined, because crowd has no brain of their own. You just give one signal to crowd and the crowd can do hell. Okay? And because crowd's whole signal, the whole antenna of the crowd is there in the hands of the leader. So the leader should be very sensible. And in this chapter, you'll get a very, very beautiful glimpse of what kind of a true leader should be. Okay, the time is over. We'll continue the chapter tomorrow from this very last paragraph. Gandhi did not leave. And children, today, Tuesday, your test day is there. And I'll be sharing the test. At what time do we share the test? 2 or 5? I'll share the test at 2 o'clock today. And you people do the test, and it will be in the form of a Google form. And whatever we have done of this chapter, right now we have covered 49th page also. So up till this page and over, and moreover, I keep on telling you so many things about the chapter from in within also. I told you the summary of the chapter in the very beginning also. So try to relate to those things all and try to attempt that Google form short paper, right? So prepare. Meanwhile, you people read the chapter. Okay? So be ready for the test today and don't miss it. And yes, one thing more. Send me the screenshot of the test, of the marks which you will get in the end. Don't forget to send me the screenshot of the marks. And the people who will not be attempting the test, they will be taken to task tomorrow. Tell all your friends.